got a connection card. If you're here on site, you can fill this out, drop it in the offering boxes at the back of the worship center, and we can get in touch with you that way. If you're not here on campus, if you're joining us at a distance, you can still go to HyattsvilleBaptistChurch.com and go over to the Connect page. Someone used it this past week to connect with us. So it does work. We will see it. If you want to send that on over there, please do as well. Be sure to hit up our direct messages on Facebook. You can comment. Brittany will say hello to you in the chat and be able to connect with you that way as well. Additionally, to pick up today, we have our Crosstalk newsletter. This is our monthly newsletter that kind of keeps you up to date on what's going on. I made the mistake first service of calling it the March 2020 newsletter. I don't think any of us want to go back to that. it is out for 2021 out there on the newsstand in the lobby. I'm going to start calling it the newsstand. I just kind of like that. I'm excited to continue on in worship. I know Dan has a lot of great songs picked out for us to sing this morning. And let's go ahead and get to that now.
Well, oh, here it is. I knew I had it bulletin up here somewhere. Hey, want to shout out, big thank you to Chris Van Hook. He came in yesterday and set up our new basketball goal out here. Looks great. And it's ready for me and Brian to dunk on. He set the height at 6'1", so we should be good. So anyway, but appreciate him doing that. Looking forward to getting the spring and the summer and be able to using that. Shout out to him. We're going to start things off with Lily of the Valley. Let's stand together and welcome each other as we sing. Here we go. I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. That's good singing. You ever choke on your own spit? That's embarrassing. Ooh, I'm sorry. First day with the new dentures. We're going to continue on. We introduced this song last week. It's a great song called Hosanna in the Highest. Let's sing together. Goes like this. I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds of fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I
I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
I see a generation.
I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, with selfless faith. I see a near revival stirring as we pray and seek. We're on our knees, we're on our knees. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. My heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like you have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, come on, church. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
As we keep on worshiping this morning, a few things to let you in on, kind of remind you about. First of all, it is the second Sunday of the month, so you know what time it is. It's business meeting time. That's what time it is. Woo! So tonight at 6 o'clock, we're going to be up in here for business meeting. If you're a member of this church, just know that's your chance to have a voice in what's going on here at Hyattsville Baptist Church. We are what we call a congregational church. That means we don't have pastors or deacons or a board or whatever ruling over and making all the decisions. Ultimately, the decisions come back to the church, and that's part of what we do during business meeting, as well as reflecting on where God's been over the last little bit here at HBC, as well as where He's leading us. It's been pretty exciting to be a part of, especially over the last year or so. I know there's been a lot of chaos, but there's also been a lot of things going on here that the Lord's been up to, and business meetings where we're able to celebrate that and discuss it the best. And so I encourage you to be a part of that. Also, it does not go out on Facebook. This is our main Sunday night that we do not broadcast out. We keep it in-house for those who are here on campus. So I encourage you to be here tonight, if at all possible. Also, last week we started back to community groups. This is a key part of our strategy here at Hyattsville Baptist Church, to be able to have true biblical community where we are spending time together, fellowshipping, sharing our lives, and studying the Word with one another. These happen on Sunday mornings right before this service. And so I hope that you are plugged into one. If you're not yet, why not start today? If you stop by the information desk on your way out this morning or connect with us through other means, we'll be happy to plug you in to a community group this coming week. We've got a number of mission things going on. One big one we've been talking a lot about is the gospel to every home. We're a part of this statewide initiative to take the good news of Jesus to every house in the Commonwealth of Kentucky in 2021. And here at Hyattsville Baptist Church, we're doing that between now and Easter. We have hit a crucial point in the process this week. We are going to be packing all 1,100 bags that we are responsible for as Hyattsville Baptist Church and getting those distributed. And so if you'd like to help with that, be sure to talk to me after service or send us some means of contact so that way we can get you plugged into it this week. Next Sunday night, we plan to distribute a large portion of those out into our community. If you can't be here next Sunday night, that's okay. You can still commit to helping distribute bags sometime between now and Easter. But next Sunday night is going to be our big main push where we go out as the body of Christ into our community and bring the good news of Jesus into the darkness. And so I am looking forward to that. I'm going to go ahead and invite Roxanne to come on up and give us a little teaser for our missions focus this month. Roxanne, take it away.
One good thing about making an announcement is you get to take your mask off. One good thing. Another good thing is we get to talk about our Annie Armstrong Easter offering. And it's collected every year right before Easter, during Easter time. And it goes to support North American missionaries. Every bit of the money that you give goes to support thousands of North American missionaries, all of their work and planting new churches and such as that. So Annie Armstrong was a lady that committed her whole life to supporting, to doing mission work in North America. And she helped start our Women's Missionary Union, which is our WMU that we have here at church, and hopefully we get to start that back soon too. And she encouraged churches to pray, to give, and to act, and the missionaries she encouraged also to give to the North American Mission offering. And so we're doing this starting now, and you can give from now until April 11th, and we'll be collecting that offering. So please pray about what the Lord would lay on your heart to give for our Annie Armstrong Easter offering this year. Thank you.
Thanks, Roxanne. And as I reminded first service, North America is the only inhabited continent on the earth where Christianity is in decline. The gospel is advancing and making gains on every continent on this planet that is inhabited except for North America. That means that our North American Mission Board of the Southern Baptist Convention needs your support now as much as ever. There is a big task at hand to reach North America in the name of Jesus Christ. So please consider how you can give to that. One other thing we've got going on here coming up is our Easter egg hunt. We need to make sure that we get those candies in. We've got a box out there in the main lobby where you can drop them off. That is by March the 24th. Did I make that up? I did not. That's the date. So March 24th, be sure to have that candy in. We want to make sure we get the eggs packed, packaged up, and ready to go weeks before Easter, so that way they are quarantined and COVID safe for our kiddos on Easter Sunday. So be sure to get that in as soon as possible, really within the next week, so that way we're able to do that ministry as well as possible. And to wrap up my church life events segment here, speaking of the pandemic, let's give a little update on where we're at on that. It's been a few weeks, and as the pandemic response team has watched the pandemic kind of as it has evolved and honestly as it has declined over the last month or so, it is to my great excitement to announce that next Sunday we'll be returning to one Sunday morning worship service, gathering back together all at one time. We'll still be social distancing and encouraging mask wearing and hand washing, but it is the plan to go back to one service next Sunday. Along with that return to one Sunday morning worship gathering, we are also going to be bringing back our children's ministries on Sunday morning next week. We'll be having community groups for our kiddos right before the worship service, just like the adults, and we'll be offering our children's church ministry for kindergarten through second grade, as well as our nursery starting next week. This has been a very thorough process. Bless the kids and youth teams for helping me think through this and the pandemic response team as we've watched the situation unfold. I know I am excited. Y'all may not remember exactly, but the business meeting of March 2020 was kind of our last normal time together. By the Wednesday after that last year, we were announcing the pandemic response plan, and by Sunday, there were no kids' ministries in place. And so, by God's grace, we are excited that 1 year to the weekend later, we are going to, Lord willing, be able to bring back our kids' ministries next week. And so if you're excited to see that, let's give a little whoop whoop as Dan comes up to continue in worship.
I don't know how to follow that up exactly. Thank you. Yeah, whoop whoop. Okay. We're going to sing one more right before Brian comes and leads us to what God has laid on his heart to share with us today, and it's really great. You're gonna love it. So let's sing together, The Power of Your Love. Here we go.
Lord, I come to you. Let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses you see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Lord, unveil my eyes, let me see you face to face. Knowledge of your love as you live in me. Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day by the power of your love. Your love surround me, bring me near, draw me by your side, and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. So hold me close, let your love surround me. side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your Spirit leads me on in the power of your love. And I will soar with you. Your Spirit leads me on in the power of your love.
Amen. Brian.
I don't know about y'all, but I like to be in control. My wife and I struggle with this as I drive a car, because I have found that my version of me being in control and her version of me being in control differ at times. Maybe all the rest of y'all are in agreement as we drive. I, however, am not, and unfortunately, she has empirical data, because every time I get out of a lane, my car starts beeping at me, telling me that I'm not in the correct lane. And then she references that to tell me, hey, get back over. And my response, oh, yes, dear, I'll be right back in that spot. Allow me to continue driving correctly. No, I'm like, I got this! I don't need your help. I don't need the car's help. I can do it. I can't do it. Not a great driver. I acknowledge that at this moment. You can come back to this whenever you like. The point of it is, we oftentimes like to be in control, be the master of situations, that we have no business acting like we have nearly as under control as we think we do. Like, I think that I'm a way better driver than I am. I'm under the opinion, if you put me in a NASCAR today, I'm competitive. There are others who would disagree. Additionally, there's all kind of other things in my life where I think I'm way better at it than I probably am. And we're all that way in one way or another. We all think that we have more control or more mastery or more skill or more whatever than we actually do. In fact, I remember a study I saw one time where most people rate themselves above average in almost every category you ask them about. If you ask people, well, on your skills as fill in the blank, how would you rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10? The average response is usually like a 6 or a 7. Y'all, if we're all 6s or 7s, then that's not right. The scale is broken. We have an inflated view of our control and of our mastery. And if I can just go ahead and just dive right into it this morning, this text that we're in, Luke 7, reminds us that above all, we must entrust our lives to the master of life and death, because the fact is, we are not as in control as we think we are. We are not as skilled as we think we are. We are not as masterful as we think we are. But our Jesus is. And we must trust ourselves to Him rather than in our own being. We're going to be in Luke chapter 7 today, going verses 1 through 17, which was pointed out to me earlier, is a palindrome. It's the same forward and backward. I had not noticed that, but shout out to Miss Allison Prather, who shot me that text earlier. That's just a little fun fact for you this morning. And as you're turning there, here's where I want us to kind of focus today. If we do not track with what Jesus says, what the example we see in Luke 7, what we're doing is we are seeking control. And when we're not in control, our lives generally are not quite as smooth. Some of us, we're not in control, we tend to get a little bit irritable, a little bit mouthy. We tend to, you know, kind of snap off on small things, you know. The cabinet door just won't stay shut, and so we slam it. And somebody's like, it's just a cabinet. Chill, bro. But it's because we're not in control. Even that little thing sometimes can set us off, right? Others of us who are maybe less wound up than myself might fall into the category of if when we're not in control, we get a little fearful. We get a little anxious. You know, you start to feel that pit in your stomach. I don't like how this is going. I don't know if this is going to work out. We start to get uneasy. We're unsure of where it's headed, and it's like, I don't know. And so I gotta get back in control of this because this is about to get out of hand fast. And some of us, when faced with a lack of control, may fall into despair. It may bring us great sorrow. You know, we're not able to control, especially the difficult things in life, and sometimes that in and of itself can consume us. And we have trouble seeing out of that tunnel. Well, in God's word today, I think he'll make it abundantly clear that we do not have control. We are not driving this ship, but the Lord is. So if you'll join me in Luke chapter 7, starting in verse number 1. It says, when he had concluded saying all this, this is talking about Jesus, referring back to the sermon that we went through last week where we saw that Jesus said, hey, in order to be blessed, in order to find favor in this life, you need to live worthy of your calling. You need to live as an underdog, loving people humbly, and build yourself on what Christ's example is, rather than always trying to be the top dog, always trying to be the one who's winning. Christ was cast aside. We should assume we will be as well. He wraps that up, and it says that he headed into Capernaum, which Capernaum was kind of a city that Jesus based his operations out of in Galilee, that region that he was ministering in. There's even some evidence that Jesus had a house in Capernaum that he kind of would come back and forth to periodically during his ministry. It says that a centurion's servant. Now, a centurion was a Roman military official. He was one of their higher-ups in their military. This military that was occupying the Jewish people at the time. So this is an occupying force ruling over this area. And one of those leaders, his servant, who was highly valued by him, who he loved, was sick and about to die. And when the centurion, when the military official heard about Jesus, when he heard about what Jesus had been saying about loving others, when he had heard about Jesus' ability to bring healing and restoration, he sent some Jewish elders to him, requesting that Jesus come and save the life of his servant. And when they had reached Jesus, these Jewish elders pleaded with him earnestly, saying, he's worthy for you to grant this. He's worthy for you to heal him. He's worthy for you to listen to this. Why? Because he loves our nation and he's built us a synagogue. Notice, they're deeming him worthy for what he has done, what he's accomplished, what he's shown them. That, oh, he's shown us love. This opposing military guy's been kind to us. He probably even worships their God. He's built them a place of worship, a synagogue. You know, hey, be nice to this guy, Jesus. He's one of the good ones. He's worthy of your time because of what he's done. And so Jesus goes with them. And when he was not far from the house, the centurion sent friends to tell him, Lord, don't trouble yourself, since I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof. Isn't that interesting? The Jewish leaders couldn't quit propping him up and how worthy he was. And his response is, no, I'm not even worthy enough for you to come to my house, Jesus. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I too, my man placed under authority, having soldiers under my command. I say to this one, go, and he goes. To another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. And listen to Jesus' response, and this is key. Because this is one of only two places in the entire New Testament that this phrase is seen. Jesus heard this and was amazed. It's one of only two times Jesus was amazed by something. One time it's good, spoiler alert, the other time it was not good. He was amazed at how unfaithful someone else was. But he was amazed here at this guy and turned to the crowd following him and said, I tell you, I've not found so great a faith even in Israel, even amongst the people who had been worshiping the Lord our God for centuries. He has not found anyone who trusted in the Lord as much as this dude. That's huge. It says that when those who had been sent returned to the house, they found the servant in good health. And afterward, he was on his way to a town called Nain, which Nain is a little village not too far away from Capernaum, also not far away from Nazareth, where Jesus was raised. So kind of Jesus' familiar territory here. His disciples and a large crowd were traveling with him, and as he neared the gate of the town, a dead man was being carried out. Now, this was fairly normal. That sounds weird to us. Like, oh, they're just carrying a dead guy through the town? That's creepy. What are they doing that for? But in Jewish culture, in ancient culture, what they would do is they would take the dead bodies out of the town to bury them, so that way they weren't keeping the dead within the town. That was their custom. And so always what they would do is they would have these big processions carrying the body out of town. It's not so dissimilar from when we have a funeral procession today. We just do it in cars and take it to a cemetery rather than just like marching through town in a parade. This man was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. A large crowd from the city was also with her, and when the Lord saw her, when Jesus saw her, notice what he had. He had compassion on her and said, don't weep. And then he came up and touched the open coffin, and the pallbearers stopped because, well, when someone rolls up on your funeral procession and starts touching around on the coffin, that's a red flag. So they stopped. And he said, young man, I tell you, get up. And the dead man sat up and started to speak. And Jesus gave him to his mother. And then fear came over everyone, you think? And they glorified God, saying, a great prophet has risen among us, and God has visited his people. And this report about him went throughout Judea and all the vicinity. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll dive in on this morning. Father God, Lord, You are the one who has authority. You are the one who is in charge. You are the one who rules the world. And yet, as that ruler, you also have compassion on us. You have love for us. And I pray this morning that we would trust you in those things. Pray that you would help us to see your compassion and your leadership side by side. As difficult as those two things are to see together so often in our lives. Pray, Lord, that we would have greater faith in you today, and that whatever distractions may be coming our way during this time of worship, that you would remove them, that we would not hear them, that we would not notice them, that we would not focus on them, that instead all we would see is you. I pray that in your name, Lord Jesus. Amen. So I got 2 points today. I'm like a half-price Baptist or something this morning. I've got 2 points instead of three. Number one, we can't control life, but he can. Y'all, if this last year has taught me anything, it may be more than it all that we are not in control of this life, because it is bonkers. There is no predicting what is coming next. If I'd have told you a year ago this weekend, hey, guess what? This will be our last normal Sunday for a year or more, and we're all going to be up in our houses for Easter. Y'all would have looked at me like I had eight heads. I would have looked at me like I had eight heads, because that was so far from the realm of possibility, we'd have never thought it possible. Wouldn't even gone there in our mind. And yet it happened. And so often in this life, both the good and the bad are wildly unpredictable. We like to think that we know how things are going to go. Like, I have a fairly regular routine on Sunday nights. I like to look the week ahead and kind of schedule myself out and plan on things, and I'll get my planner out in my calendar and I'm getting it all organized. And inevitably, at some point in the week, that's not going to come into play anymore, because something in this world is going to throw it off kilter. It happens every week. And it happens for you too, right? Like you think that you know what's going to happen every day, but inevitably, sometimes we don't. We receive that, ideally, that promotion or that good news or that encouragement or that card from a friend, or we get to go on that surprise dinner date, hint, hint, husbands, hit that up, or, you know, whatever good things, or we're blindsided by the bad. But either way, this life is rarely predictable. And you've got to think that this centurion did not predict anything that was going on in his life. He probably didn't even expect to be in Israel at this point, but he is. He certainly didn't expect to be loved by the people in the town he was occupying, but he was. He probably didn't anticipate when he got there building them a place to worship, and yet here we are, he's done that. Probably didn't expect to be connected in intimately with his servants, where he actually cared about what happened to him, that he actually loved him, and yet he did. He cared about his well-being. And he probably didn't expect to hear about this healing teacher that's wandering through the countryside doing all these amazing things and being like, I'll trust in that guy to heal my servant who needs healing. I bet he didn't foresee any of that coming ahead of time. And yet, in all of that unforeseen situation, we see a remarkable faith. We see a remarkable trust in this military leader, in our Jesus. A trust that starts with humility, that starts with saying, I'm not worthy of you, I'm not worthy of who you are. I'm not worthy for you to even be in my house. You are so beyond me. And it continues on to showing why he says he's not worthy. This isn't just him being like, woe is me, I'm a miserable person, I'm not worthy. And some kind of like Eeyore vibes, like, oh, it's just a bad day. No. His reason for saying he's not worthy is because he understands who he's talking to. He understands the authority that Christ demands. He compares him to himself in a sense, because he says, look, I get it. I'm a guy of authority. I'm a military commander, dude. I'm out here, you know, saying, hey, soldiers, go there. And they go and come over here and they come over here and do this and they do this. I understand. And what he sees is that Jesus is the commander of everything. He's the one who tells the wind to blow. He's the one who tells our heart to beat. He's the one who tells the sun to rise and the sun to set. He's the one who tells the leaves in the spring to grow and the one who tells them in the fall to shrivel. Our Jesus is in control. And that goes for every aspect of our lives. There's no point in this life where Jesus isn't in charge. And that includes the difficult times. That includes the pain and the hardship. Because it's really easy for us to work with that when everything's going great. But you know when it's not easy? Is when we get that doctor visit that doesn't go the way we planned it. When we receive that news from work or from the interview that didn't go how we wanted. When we learn of that betrayal, that loss of trust that hits us and knocks the wind out of us. It's hard to work at those moments with the fact that our Jesus is still in control. Now, it's worth pointing out, our Jesus does not cause evil. The Bible makes that abundantly clear. He is not the one who causes evil in this world, but he certainly allows it. The devil is not running amok in this world unchecked and under the same amount of authority as our Jesus. He's not. He is on a leash like a dog in the yard. But as such, that makes the difficulties in this life hard for us to grapple with at times. Because there are moments in this life where we want to say, well, Jesus, if you're in charge, if you have authority, if you're ruling this dominion, then why am I going through this? Why am I facing this? Why am I here? Why did we get that news? It's not easy. And that's why it's called faith. That's why it's called trust. Notice what the centurion has here. I have not found so great a faith in all of Israel. Faith is believing in what is not yet seen. And in this story with the centurion, we see this military leader looking at Jesus and saying, I can't handle this. But I'm going to put my faith, I'm going to put my trust, I'm going to believe that you can. I'm going to believe that you can heal my servant if you want. I'm going to believe that you have that authority. I turn it over to you. Faith is not trusting in Jesus to do what we want him to do. Faith is trusting that Jesus can do as he is able, and we will work with whatever comes out of it. That's real faith. That's not easy. That's not mushy-gushy feels good all the time. But that's faith, is trusting that our God is in control, that our God knows best, that our God reigns and knows better, even when it runs contrary to what we think. Because I can tell you, there's been plenty of times in my life, and I know in your lives as well, that we would have done things in this world differently had it been left up to us. But that's not the way it went. And faith is looking at those situations and still saying to our God, I know you've got this. I don't understand it. I don't like it. But I know you've got it. And that doesn't just go for this life. That goes for number two, the fact that we can't control death either. But he can. The woman going through this town, with her being a widow, that means she's already buried her husband at this point. Now she's burying her only son. And in that culture, what that would have meant is not only had she lost her husband, not only had she lost her only remaining family member and her son, but also very soon, because she wouldn't have a way to provide for herself, she would be losing her home and her possessions because she could not afford to keep them, and she would have become a beggar on the streets, hoping and praying that someone would throw her a coin to get bread. This woman was not just losing her family, as painful as that was, she was about to lose it all. And in that moment, it's worth note that our Jesus saw her in that. When she felt like and likely was going to lose everything, he looked at her and had compassion for her. And it can get easy to get bitter in this passage, because we see that the way this story goes, the dead boy gets up. Mom and child, they're reunited, and that's miraculous and wonderful. But it can also lead us to ask, well, what about my loved one? What about the person I lost? What about the one I hold dear? They didn't pop back up. I was hurting. I was in loss. Why didn't I see that resurrection? Does Jesus not have compassion for me too? Friend, I want to tell you this. That while faith requires that we trust whatever the outcome is, our Jesus loves you no matter what that outcome is. And that's not easy to grapple with. I don't want to sit here and act like it is. It would be ridiculous for me to sit here and act like, yeah, so just put your faith that Jesus loves you and everything's going to be okay. While that's true, in essence, while it is true, that doesn't make it easy. That doesn't make it fun. This life is not easy. And any preacher that tells you it's going to be if you just trust in Jesus is a lying snake. That's not what the Bible says at all. What the Bible says is that we have a God who is in control, who is victorious over evil, who is a God of resurrection and renewal, and that even when things go wrong in life and in death, no matter what it is, He is still the one in charge, and He brings resurrection and redemption and glory out of it, no matter how unlikely that may be. That is our God. Sometimes a forest requires a forest fire in order to experience a deeper level of growth than it could attain before. That doesn't mean that the forest wants to get burnt down any more than the rest of us want to experience the hurt and the loss in our lives. Forest fires hurt. And the forest fires of our lives hurt. But amidst that black soot, amidst the pain and the hurt and the loss that you today may very well be feeling, all up in that hurt and that confusion and the pain that you feel, and I know some of y'all's story in this room, I know that you are going through it in a way that I cannot even understand. In the middle of that, our God has plans for beauty, for glory, for redemption, for renewal, for revival, and opportunities that you this morning will be able to speak life, speak truth, speak His glory into situations that I and other people cannot do. Because you will have been somewhere that the rest of us have not. And while it doesn't make it easy, it does give a purpose to the pain. There is a reason in it that doesn't negate the hurt. Both things are true. I can tell you, as we come near our close this morning, that difficulty in life, it's not easy, and it's never going to be. This is a broken world. It's broken. It's messed up. And until our Jesus brings full restoration and revival to it, we're left to pick up the pieces. We're left to put it all back together when we lose our jobs, or we go through that injury, or we get that cancer diagnosis, or we get that bit of bad news, when we feel isolated and alone, when we feel shut out and betrayed, when we go through the hurt of this life, we can trust that our Jesus is in charge and that our Jesus loves us in it, and He will see us to the other side and to a purpose in the middle of it. As difficult as that may be, hold the faith. Keep Him close. He will see you to the other side. Let's pray. Father God, I pray this morning, Lord, help us in your grace. Work through our suffering. Work through our hurt. Work through the fact that, Lord, we know that you have authority over all, that you're in charge. We know that you love us, but God, it does not always feel like that. It's not always easy to believe that. It's not always easy to walk in that. Sometimes, Lord, there's nothing harder than to trust that you have control and love in our hurt and our pain. But I know, Lord God, I know that you do. Help us to feel that this morning. I pray especially for those today who may be experiencing great pain, who may be experiencing great loss, Lord, that you would bring them hope in the gospel of Jesus Christ, that you would bring them hope in the ultimate story of resurrection and in healing. It's in your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen. As we wrap it up this morning, this is your opportunity to respond. I know that there are a lot of hurting hearts with me today. People who have lost much, who are going through much right now. Our Jesus loves you. He sees you in your hurt. And he is holding you close, whether it seems that way or not. And so if you've never trusted in Jesus as your Lord and Savior before today, today is the day. Our God is in the business of resurrection. Our God's in the business of taking what is dead and broken and hurting and lost and bringing it into life and beauty and glory. That's what our Jesus does. And it starts with our souls. If your soul has not been brought to resurrection in Christ today, then you are dead in your sins. You are dead in your rebellion. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to see that resurrection. We'd love to talk to you about it. We've got a prayer room in the back. I'll be available after service, or if you're online with us right now, you can hop in the comments. We'd love to talk to you about it. Maybe you want to talk about following Jesus in baptism, the public declaration of our faith and that we have decided to live a new life in Christ Jesus. We've experienced that resurrection, and it's time to get living it. Let's set that up. Maybe it's becoming a member of this church and formally joining us together in our mission to bring this healing, this restoration into a hurting world. Or maybe you're called into a specific ministry, or maybe just today you're just feeling that you need to respond to this in some way. That you need to cry out before God about your hurt and your pain and your brokenness. Do that now. As David sings and leads us, don't let this pass by. Don't worry about what anyone else is doing or might see you do. This is your opportunity to respond. Do not let it pass by. And let's do it. Well, thank y'all for being with us for worship, either here in person or online. Remember, tonight at 6 o'clock, business meeting. as we continue to see what God's up to. We're also specifically tonight going to be talking about worship times starting next Sunday and figuring out our going back to one service and talking that through. And so I'd love for you to be a part of that conversation with us tonight. I'm looking forward to it. I'm wore out, y'all. I'm wore out, and that's a good kind of wore out. So with that, Jonathan's going to pray to close us out. I hope to see you again soon.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you for allowing us to come out to your house. Just thank you for the opportunity to worship as a family. I just ask that you let us take Brian's word to heart, and through all the good and bad, the hurt and sickness, just let us give you our problems, and because you're in control. And just ask that if there's anyone here that's not made the decision to follow you, just let them do that before it's eternally too late. Just be with us as we go our separate ways. Let us be a light for you in the community. In your name I pray, amen.